A new group of studies into racial disparities among people with Alzheimer's disease suggests that social conditions, including the stress of poverty and racism, substantially raise the risk of dementia of African Americans. Good morning. I'm Ed James, and welcome to Black Almanac. In four separate studies, researchers found that conditions that affect blacks disproportionately compared with other groups, such as poor living conditions and stressful events such as the loss of a sibling, the divorce of parents, and chronic unemployment, have severe consequences for long-range brain health later on. Clinical psychologist Dr. Eddie Renier shares his insight and analysis. Dr. Renier, I want to thank you for coming today and sharing with our audience. I saw results of several reports recently, and frankly, I was disturbed. I did not realize that stress led to dementia and Alzheimer's, and then especially in communities of color, we're loaded with stress from all sorts of situations. And then when we were talking off camera, you said, yeah, and stress will kill you.
Yes.
Explain that concept, if you will.
First of all, the word stress is probably a misnomer that people take too lightly. What stress is, and probably should have a better word for it, is the body's response to attempt to adapt to new novel situations. And so there are two types of ways the body adapt. Short-term stress, acute stress, that is the daily things that happen to us that we have to cope with. And those things are not really harmful. In fact, short-term stress may make you more alert, may make you more oriented, more focused. The problem we have is chronic long-term stress. And what that does, long-term stress, is that your brain and your body attempts to adapt to the long-term stress that's caused by many things: family discord, economic stress, living in an unsafe neighborhood, not having access to food or health care. All these things force us to adapt to those unpleasant situations, and we have to adapt to them. And your body produces what's called glucocorticoids. Your brain produces this. We call this the stress hormone. Prolonged release of stress hormone in our brain causes destruction of the hippocampus system, part of the limbic structure. That is the area of the brain that has memory and learning. And if you lose enough of your hippocampus, then you begin to have memory problems and attention span problems. But stress, chronic stress, has far more harmful effect than that. Chronic stress can affect your immune system and prematurely age it. And when your immune system prematurely age, that is, you get disease, you get sick. Chronic stress can cause hypertension, high blood pressure. High blood pressure can lead to strokes, can lead to damage to internal organs, to heart, causing coronary disease, heart attacks, and clogged arteries, and can result in death. It can also impair cognitive functions like dementia. So stress is not a minor thing. The problem is most of us take it for granted. For African Americans, in addition to these usual stressors that bother everybody else, we have the stress of discrimination. So in fact, when people perceive that they're being discriminated against, it tends to change their behavior in predictable ways. They may act irrationally by drinking. They may use tobacco or drugs to calm themselves down. And those things have their own health effects. Discrimination may make us not go to doctors and avoid going to medical facilities, so we don't get timely treatment for hypertension and strokes. We may delay calling the doctor because we perceive we're going to be mistreated by the healthcare system.
What about economics? I mean, just plain economics, chronic unemployment.
You know, there's disparity there for African Americans. We have more people unemployed than in majority communities. And so economic stress is a major, major stress, and tend for us to be chronic and unrelenting, which means glucocorticoids will be released, extended release of it, and damaging brain structures, leading to cognitive impairment, and so less ability to adapt. So economic stress, living in a neighborhood where people did just drive-by shootings, not eating properly, having poor access to food and healthcare systems, all of these can create stress, and this stress is deadly.
One of the things that I'm hearing, that since the party in power in Washington is talking about getting rid of the healthcare system as we know it, and we have more people who are getting healthcare for the first time than ever, not repairing it or doing something where there are issues with it, but just repeal and replace. Now, they've talked about that for ever since President Obama came into office. In fact, on the day of the inauguration, and my friend Chris is echoing me in the background. He's telling me that he agrees. Anyway, what is happening, and now they're worried about, will they have health care? And the poorest of the poor, those who are receiving Medicaid, and Medicaid is not just for being poor, but it's disabled and all of these things. What's happening? How are they functioning?
Well, here we have. We've had, you know, if you listen to the data being presented by the media, we have, at one point we had some 30 to 40 million Americans uninsured. And so those people, when they had emergencies, went to the emergency rooms for treatment, the most costly form of treatment. The tragedy of this is that if you have a primary care doctor who works with you and sees you twice a year for medical, routine medical checkups, they know you, they know your history, and you feel comfortable with them. And so if you have a problem, you're more likely to call them before it's an emergency, mm-hmm. and therefore get timely care, the most least expensive care. If you waiting to have emergencies to go to the emergency room because you don't have a primary care doctor, the most costly form, also the poorest outcome comes from those. Therefore, having health insurance for people is humane and leads to better outcome, because they'll have a primary care doctor who knows their situation.
One of the things that we hear, that America is an exceptional country. Now, those who were opposed to the former president says he does not recognize America's exceptionalism. But we're the only industrialized nation in the world that does not have health care for everyone. That's exceptional.
I think you're right. Let's look at it this way. If you have people who are sick in ways and with illnesses that we know how to treat, for example, we know how to reduce the negative impact of a stroke. We can control blood pressure very easily. In fact, drugstores and supermarkets dispense antihypertensive free. Mm-hmm. But to get it, you have to have a prescription. Mm-hmm. And you have to know you have a condition called hypertension. To do that, you have to consult a physician. And there's two sides to this. You have to believe you can pay for it to go see the physician, and the physician has to understand you, something about you. Mm-hmm. So there's the provider bias and also the patient bias. You have to brave society to understand you won't be discriminated against to go to a doctor, to go pursue them. And they have to treat you with courtesy so that you will come back. But all that, what primes the engine for that is a health card insurance that pays for the services. Now, someone who's healthy, who doesn't have strokes, whose blood pressure is under control, can work, pay taxes, and contribute to society, be a parent, be a neighbor, and mow their own grass and do things with us. Someone who's struggling with hypertension and is having strokes and coronary disease is a burden to their family, to the community. And what's tragic about this, it's all preventable, with low cost preventable, if that person only had a health care insurance. So if our country is going to be compassionate for those Americans, for those of us who have less money and less education, at least make an insurance card available, insurance coverage available, so they can get routine medical care to prevent the easily preventable diseases like coronary disease, heart attacks, high blood pressure, diabetes, strokes. We can prevent those very easily with education. What you need is a health care provider.
Well, I want to talk a little bit about dementia, Alzheimer's. Dementia is just a form, one form, I understand, many forms of Alzheimer's.
Yes.
And we often talk about dementia, but we don't know what we're talking about. We know that it's Alzheimer's, and we don't know what it is, but we say that. And we treat it as some foreign thing that if you live long enough, you automatically going to get it. But that's not true. And you're saying that it's preventable.
Yeah. For many African Americans, particularly the Alzheimer's, that some research suggests is linked to racial discrimination because of prolonged stress, are certainly preventable. And because with education, people can learn how to manage stress. They can learn how to lower the load of stress, so they don't succumb to the long-term effects of stress. We all have to live with stress. But if we learn how to manage it, if we exercise, we eat properly, and we avoid certain foods, we can significantly reduce the long-term effect of stress and avoid the consequences of Alzheimer's. Alzheimer's is a complicated disease. It's not easily diagnosed. In fact, one of the ways, the best way to diagnose is after somebody died and we do an autopsy, we find certain changes to the brain and we say, now we know really it was Alzheimer's. However, we've been trying to find easier ways of diagnosing it. Just because you have a memory deficit doesn't mean you have Alzheimer's. Stress can cause you to not see something going on. You can be preoccupied, distracted. So there are lots of causes of memory deficit. We don't have to call it stress. We don't have to call it Alzheimer's. However, we do know that if we manage stress better, there are ways to learn how to do this. We can avoid the long-term consequences of stress. And for many people who have stress-related Alzheimer's, stress-related dementia, we can avoid it altogether.
This past Thursday in Barcelona, Spain, there was a terrorist attack. One guy with a van, 32 were injured. He just found the busiest streets, one of the business streets, one of the larger boulevards, and just ran through them. Then last week, we saw the beginning of something that's been on the back burner, but we saw it rear its ugly head when the alt-right of the Ku Klux Klan or the white nationalists or the white supremacists, some of all of them came together in Charlottesville, Virginia, a normal college town that has a good reputation of people getting along with. The first thing we saw was on that night, this group of people walking with burning flames on sticks, burning and walking through the campus, walking through the campus, making racial slurs and slogans opposing Jews and black folk and everyone who was not a white American. Then the next day, we saw a demonstration in daylight. If they didn't scare enough people at night, that was, because that's the old way, that's what the Klan did, rode at night. They came out again with their shields. This is interesting. Shields, sticks, and helmets, and started. But there were good people, counter-protesters, who were out also saying they weren't going to let these people take their country. Then the next thing we have, we found out later on, a guy who was a follower, drove all the way from Ohio to Virginia. We saw on the newsreels with him demonstrating first and making noise the evening before. And then that day, he gets in his car and speeds into a crowd of people who were doing a peaceful counter-demonstration. He didn't stop until he hit another car that was parked there. And then you see him backing out with the front of his bumper hanging off. And at the end of that, one person was killed and another 19 injured. And we didn't hear from our president, of the president. I'm reluctant to say our president because I think he has shown by this, in the way he handled this incident, that he's the president of the others, other than people of color, and president of everyone. How stressful must this have been?
Ed, what a great question. I saw those images on TV myself. I saw the Nazi flag. I saw the tiki torches march. It looked to me, I could see past the khaki pants and the shirts. It looked like white sheets in the hoods. I remember those days. And as I saw it, I began to tremble. I was scared. This is something I thought in our history we had overcome long ago. And to see it back at my age was extremely stressful. And I thought about my people, and also white people, and brown people, and Hispanics, and Christians who marched with Martin Luther King and us in the 60s, who faced the dogs and the high-pressure hoses and the batons, and all the people who died. Some of my friends died in that time, fighting hatred that I thought was behind us. All those memories came back, and I thought about my people, and I said, how horrible. And when I say my people, I mean the better part of America, because we didn't get social justice in the 60s just with us. We got social justice because America showed up to give us social justice. They faced the brutality with us. And I was thinking, how horrible for us. We can't retire. The work isn't over. I thought of all that. Hatred seeks to destroy, burn, and create trouble. But the next day, there was another demonstration, candlelight yes. demonstration of good Americans, Americans of different creed, different groups, different places, who marched in peace and brotherly love, who were true Christians, who truly love America.
You're talking about the candlelight vigil.
The candlelight vigil. Mm-hmm. And then I remembered it brought back the memories that we were not alone. We African Americans and Jewish people, we are not alone. There is a greater America, a better America, more of us than them. And I really truly believe that the love that I saw in that group, in that demonstration the next day, is what America truly is about. Hatred has its moment of destruction, but love conquers because we build lasting monuments. And I am hoping and I'm praying that that better America comes out again and more just like that, to show that we do have compassion, we do have love, because we will build lasting monuments.
One of the things, as we talked, and we talked a little bit off camera early on, before we started the show, is that we talk about people being who they are. And everyone says, Trump, 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 and what Trump is, and what he isn't, and what he's doing. But America knew who Trump was before he was elected president. Trump's history has been one of loving himself, not loving others. If you remember, and some of us weren't listening or watching, but the president spent the first year of his predecessor, President Obama, talking about he wasn't an American. He wasn't even born here. But they still voted for him. Then during the election, it came out in his own mouth, and he talked about, because he was a celebrity, he could grope women in their private parts and they wouldn't say anything because he was a celebrity. And I go back further than that, and I remember before an election in New York City, where several black boys were picked up and brutalized and taken to jail for allegedly raping a woman. They were called the Central Park Nine in New York Central Park. And he took out a full-page ad in the newspaper saying that they should be given the electric chair, and he being the current president. And then years later, it was found out that those young men were guilty of absolutely nothing. And they found out, and then you apologize, you release them from jail. But if he had had his way, meaning the current president, they would have been executed. How do we say that we did not know? And as the young lady who was killed in Virginia said, if you don't know, you haven't been listening. And I think what the president showed coming out of Virginia, that yes, I am the president of the right, not people who do the right thing, but that group called the alt-right, the KKK, the white nationalists, the white supremacists, because he has yet to speak to that family of the young lady. I don't know.
And what I see on TV is, for me, is abysmal. I think President Trump is a symptom of a nation divided. We are going through technological changes in automation changes that's taking a lot of jobs away, and they're going to continue to take jobs away. And many Americans are struggling with the changes, just like we did earlier at the turn of the last century when there was industrialization had taken place. Mm-hmm. That's creating fear, and people, when in fear, people blame other people for it, rather than to look at, we need to go back to school and relearn new skills, new trades. Rather than that, we blame Hispanics and we blame others. And so Trump was talking language that people were willing to risk, place him in the presidency, because they thought he would solve the economic problem. They were willing to forgive, to not hear this other side of Trump. And I think that's why we have a president like this. And I think that I blame the educated group for not talking about why there is an economic problem. Trump is not going to bring more jobs. He can't, because the problem is not that there's too many Mexicans or too many Hispanics or too many black people. The problem is that there's automation and there's technological changes, and they're going to accelerate, not decelerate. And the educated class need to take a leadership role to discuss these changes in our society and create opportunities for people to retool. Because then we'll stop blaming other people, and Trump will be a footnote in history.
Well, Dr. Rene, I want to thank you for coming and sharing with our audience. And remember, they may come for me in the morning, but they'll come for you at night. Have a great day, Suncoast. 6 p.m. to 7:30 p.m. at the Robert L. Taylor Community Complex, 1834 John Rivers Street, Sarasota, Florida. For more information, contact Trevor Harvey, 941-355-2097, or Helen James, 941-228-8191. Bethlehem Bible Church Male Choir celebrates 10 years of ministering songs for the Lord, featuring Marsha Page, other local male choirs also. August 27th at 4 p.m., Bethlehem Bible Church, 1680 18th Street, Sarasota, Florida.